sermon text for today is Exodus chapter 6, verses 2 through 8. God spoke to Moses and said to him, I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land in which they lived as sojourners. Moreover, I have heard the groanings of the people of Israel, whom the Egyptians hold as slaves, and I have remembered my covenant. Say therefore to the people of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will deliver you from slavery to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great acts of judgment. I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who has brought you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will bring you into the land that I swore to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you for a possession. I am the Lord.
Let's pray. God of mercy and grace, we are honored to open your word, and we eagerly await our study of your word together. We first, though, ask, recognizing that we are in need of you. So we're praying, God, that you would work in your word and through your word. You've blessed to inspire the word, and Lord God, now we're asking you to work to open our eyes to see the glory of you, our God, as revealed in your scriptures. Help us to see the glory of you and of your Christ. Help us to grow, not just in a few Bible facts and a little bit of knowledge, but Lord God, in a love for you. May we worship you today. May we see aspects of your great glory that we didn't previously see. Help us to love what you reveal about yourself here. Help us to embrace it and to see this as glorious. Lord God, thank you for the treasure of your word that shows us and leads us to our great treasure, which is you. Bless us as your people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're in the middle of a sermon series going through the Old Testament. We've taken a few weeks off, but here we are back to it. And what we are trying to do is put the whole Bible together. So we are going through the Old Testament, but we don't mean to say everything there is to say. Today we'll look at a large part of what's going on in Exodus 1 through 18. We'll leave some things unsaid. We'll pick that up next week. But I want to just remind us a little bit about where we've come. What we're trying to do is we want to say, and many people have said, so we're not saying anything unique or original, that the story of the Bible is the story of God taking us from Eden all the way to heaven. And sometimes people put that basic storyline under four heads. That the four main points would be creation, God made everything perfect, and then the fall, we messed it all up, and you've only got three chapters, and you've already got the first two points. And it goes all the way to the New Testament when you get redemption, although redemption is getting worked out, moving toward, right, a promise made eventually is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Redemption happens in him, and we finally look forward to the consummation, or what we would call heaven, the new heavens and the new earth. And so that's the story of the Bible, and we're trying to put how that story kind of flows through the Old Testament. When we looked at Genesis, for a number of weeks, we saw again that God had made everything, and he'd made everything perfect. And one interesting fact that we need to kind of like highlight to help us put our whole Bible together is that what happens in the curse in Genesis 3:15 is that God basically says when he curses the serpent, He says, I'm going to make a division between your offspring or your seed and the seed of the woman. Isn't that interesting? And by the way, that's the kind of division that you probably already see. The division you see in this world is that the whole world is divided along the lines of God. And as a matter of fact, the whole world is not just divided along the lines of God. To press the matter a little more further, the whole world is divided along the lines of God's Christ, that is Jesus, the one who saves sinners. Some people claim to worship the same God that we do and reject Jesus Christ as the Savior of sinners, and they too fall outside of those who are truly God's redeemed people. And so the whole world then is divided along the lines of those who have been reconciled to God through Jesus Christ and those who have not. And that division starts as early as Genesis chapter 3, right after the fall, seed of the serpent, seed of the woman. That division is there, and we'll see that through the whole Bible. And so then we see God taking a man and making a promise to him. This man is named Abraham. This happens in Genesis chapter 12. And he says to him, I'm going to make you a great nation. You're going to be a blessing. In you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And here God is indicating that Abraham, this man of faith, is the one through whom he will bring salvation. This, the seed of the woman, the one who ultimately salvation will come through. And again, now we begin to pick teams, if you want to say that. We're picking teams, and it's Abraham's team. Are you on Abraham's team? Because that's the one that Jesus comes through. Are you on his team? And as you begin to follow then the Old Testament through, you're going to find Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and on through. When we get to Israel, this is leading us to Exodus, to Israel being, as it were, God's, the people who are on God's side. Now, again, this story gets a little bit confused because sometimes Israel acts in unbelief. And yet, in general, God means to effect salvation through Abraham's line. And so when we come to Exodus, we see the seed of the man and the seed of the woman, I mean, seed of Satan and seed of the woman, at odds, and who are the two teams? Well, those who are the seed of the serpent, who are basically in unbelief, outside of God, not reconciled to God, that's Egypt. And those who are God's people is Israel. And how will God deal in this altercation between his people and those who aren't his people, those who reject him? See the storyline here. And so now we're here in Exodus, and we're trying to put this all together. And what we have in these first 18 chapters is just a basic story. If you've been in Sunday school, you grew up in Sunday school, you'll know these stories. There's lots of very familiar ones. And basically, it takes God's people from Egypt, it takes them through the Red Sea, and it sends them right at the base of Mount Sinai. That's where they get the Ten Commandments. Now, we're not going to talk about the Ten Commandments this week, but that's the part of the story we're going to look at. And there's a lot of familiar things you would know, again, as you probably remember from Sunday school, the idea that there's this man named Moses, right? And you know, we have God's people that are growing, and you have Pharaoh not knowing the Lord, right? And he decides he's going to kill the males of Israel. And God preserves this one named Moses, and his, you know, is put in the bulrushes. And these are great stories, and I wish we had time to cover them all. But this is how God supernaturally preserves the life of one called Moses, ultimately sending Moses out away from Israel, and then brings him back to lead the people. And so what we have here is that what happens in that time period when Moses is sent away is that there's this note in chapter 2, verse 23. Let me just read it to you. Their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God. See, Israel is are slaves in Egypt, and they say, God, can you help us? And this is a wonderful thing to do if you ever find yourself in need of help. And it's beyond you. Call out to God. Don't try to figure it out on your own. Call out to the Lord and know that nothing is too difficult for him. Here we have this nation, and they are slaves against a very powerful Egyptian nation. Right? And this is something that they cannot take care of on their own. And so they say, God, help us. Israel cannot take care of Egypt on their own. And so they call out to God for help. Well, anyway, as we continue to move through this story, God calls Moses. He eventually sends Moses in to tell Pharaoh to let his people go. And it takes 10 plagues to do it. But finally, the Egyptians are ready to let God's people go. And so even in the deliverance, doesn't Pharaoh change his mind and wants to come after them? And there's this crisis point where they're at the edge of the Red Sea and the water's before them, and Egypt's coming behind them, and yet the Lord powerfully delivers them. We'll spend a few minutes thinking about that a little bit, in a few minutes. Pharaoh's army is eventually destroyed, and then the people finally go through and they're saved. And so this is a wonderful story. It's a wonderful narrative. And what I want to do is to drop down in on a couple important points. And one important point that we need to see is that God's glory, you need to see God's glory, by the way, God's glory is seen in the way that he powerfully delivers his people. This is the kind of thing that is put in the Bible to stir you up to love your powerful God. So I pray that the Lord is working in your heart to love a powerful God and to love that he is so powerful and to love that he's your God. That's why these stories are here. That's why they're in here. They're not for you to just know facts. They're to help your heart love this powerful God. And so we want to spend a few minutes looking at this. One of the things I want to use is sort of a point of reference here is this amazing interaction when Moses first goes to Pharaoh and says to Pharaoh, God says, let my people go. And Pharaoh says this phrase. It's just a very interesting phrase. It's in chapter 5, verse 2. But Pharaoh says, who is the Lord? Isn't that interesting? Who is the Lord? I am Pharaoh. Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? And again, this is one who thinks much of himself. And yet he asks a very essential question. In a sense, he's already answered the question himself. He doesn't think much of the Lord. And yet I want you to think that there's nothing more important to you than for you to figure out who is this Lord. Who is the Lord? Do you know the Lord? Who is the Lord? And again, we're going to learn a little bit about who this Lord is. We've already seen in our study of Genesis, he's the creator and sustainer of everything. He's the one who made everything just with words. He's a powerful God. And he actually continues to sustain you now. You're breathing because God has willed it. And if he ever stops willing it, you'll stop breathing. That's how it works. And so he's a powerful God. He made all things for him and for his glory. And again, in the fall, all mankind rejected that and found themselves needing a redeemer. And so one of the things that our text affirms, and I just want to affirm this to you now, is that God, who is the Lord? The answer to that question basically looks something like this. At least this is an important part of it. He's the best friend you could ever have and the worst enemy you could ever have. God is the best friend any person could ever have, and yet be warned, don't set yourself against him, because you cannot imagine a more terrifying enemy than this God. And again, this text will bear that out. I think sometimes we don't strike the right balance of this in our churches. Sometimes we just have people who love to talk about how dangerous it is to be opposed to God. And by the way, this text bears it out. It's very dangerous. Don't set yourself against him. It's a really bad idea. You'll one day find out just how bad of an idea that it was. So we are right to not ignore that. That's correct. And yet, that doesn't help you love him, does it? And the Bible doesn't want you to like be scared of God. He wants you to see how wonderful it is to be his friend and to say, I am his friend through Jesus and I love him. That's what he wants us to do. And so what we also want to do at the same time, even as we know that it is terrifying to fall into the hands of a living God, we also want to say there's nothing more joy-giving than to be his friend. To know that he could crush you and instead he sent his son to die for you so that you can have fellowship with him. There's no better friend you can have than this powerful God. And so today we want to see this Lord is one whose glory is seen in keeping his covenant promises. It's interesting. There's this idea of covenant. We made reference to it. It shows up in Genesis chapter 12 and again in chapter 15 that God makes a covenant with Abraham. And that covenant keeps getting referenced even in our passage. This I read earlier where the people called out to God to save them in chapter 2 verse 23 and chapter verse 24, the very next verse says this, and God heard their groaning. So they basically said, save us. And God says, I hear you. God heard their groanings and God remembered his covenant. He had said he was going to do them good. He remembered it. He said, I'm going to do you good. And he remembers, I told them I would do them good. I'm going to do good to them. I've already told them that I would. He remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. Again, even in our text that we read at the beginning of the sermon, we see covenant being mentioned in chapter 6, verses 4, and again in verse 5. This idea of covenant comes up. And what does God say he will do in respect to his covenant? Well, in verse 6, he says, I will deliver. Or again, he says, I will redeem. And then let me read verse 7 again. I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God. And you will know that I am the Lord your God who has brought you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. God saved a people. Isn't this a beautiful description? He will be your God and you will be his people. He will shelter you, protect you, defend you. It's a beautiful Bible truth. He will protect you. He cares for you. He loves you. And yet what we see here, though, is that God is saving a people not to be their own, but to be his own. There's nothing in the Bible that makes you think, well, all that God is really good for is saving you, and then you should just go do what you want. He saved you to be his own. We gather here as those who are glad to be his own. I'm glad that I belong to the Lord and I submit to his word and to his will. It's a wonderful thing to find yourself saying, I will gladly do whatever you call me to do, God. But he hasn't called you and saved you to just do whatever you want, but to gladly submit to him. Well, he will deliver them, he will fight for them, he will provide for them, he will bless them. And all this is related to this covenant he's made. He just took Abraham and he just set his love on him and made a promise and said, through you I'm going to bless the whole earth. And here he is keeping that promise. Now, one of the other things we need to see is God's awe-inspiring power. Sometimes power can terrorize you, especially if you recognize that your enemy is really, really powerful. It's terrifying, right? And yet for those who are his friend, there's nothing more comforting than to know that the one who is the most powerful will use all of that power for your protection. And again, this is again why we emphasize nothing better to be the friend of Jesus. And nothing more terrifying than to be his enemy, because there's no power that can compare to him. All the powers of the earth combined together will not stand in their rebellion against him. And so let's look at some of this awe-inspiring power. And if you are God's child, just rejoice that this power is for your good. We see it first in chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. We see this Moses is called, and there's this burning bush experience. The bush is burning, it's not consumed, and the Lord speaks to Moses and says he remembers his covenant. Again, reference to the covenant. And Moses responds. And in this, look at the way that Moses responds. He says, in the first part, he says in verse 6, this is the Lord speaking. He said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face and was afraid to look at the Lord. If we had time, we would just take a little trip through the Bible to show how consistent this is with the other ways that people, when they come face to face with someone so powerful and glorious, find themselves properly reverential, properly in awe, properly debased, so that they recognize their place. I know for myself, I could do with more apprehending the glory of God. Each time that the Lord grants us a growth in that, there is a corresponding lowering of our pride and of our high thoughts of ourselves, isn't it? And so here is an awesome God standing before Moses, and Moses is just fearful. Again, God's awesome might inspires reference. Man is reminded that he's small compared to this powerful God. That I'm not the most important. My will, not ultimate. His will is ultimate. I know my obligation is to do the will of this one who is so awesome. I might also remember my sin. May God grant us a greater apprehension of his glory, leading us to a proper reverence and submission and worship and love of this glorious God. I'll spend a few minutes talking about God's power seen in Pharaoh's life. You know, I don't know what you think about how God works in this world, but the Bible explains that God is very active. This will be one of our themes, by the way. God is very active in this world. The world doesn't think he's active, and some people in the church doesn't seem to think that God is active. And yet the Bible makes it clear God is very active. One of the things you may be surprised to know is that God is the one who made Pharaoh, Pharaoh. Exodus 9, verse 16. For this purpose I have raised you up. The Lord is speaking to Pharaoh. I have raised you up, Pharaoh. I have raised you up. God takes the credit for Pharaoh being on the throne. And he says to the mere mortal that he has put on the throne, I have put you here to show you my power. God wants to take the strongest and the most powerful on the earth, and he wants to say, you may think you have power, but God has ultimate power. God is eager to do this in kings' lives and in our lives. What do you have that God hasn't given you? What authority do you have? What wisdom do you have? What position do you have that the Lord hasn't given you? If he can say to Pharaoh, I put you there, and what I want you to see is that I have way more power than you do. You are out of your league, Pharaoh. So that my name would be proclaimed in all the earth. Not only does God want Pharaoh to see that he's way more powerful than Pharaoh, he wants himself to act in this world so that God's name would be proclaimed in all the earth. The proclamation of a powerful God is what we are to be about. He wants his power to be proclaimed in this earth. Again, kings on the throne are only there by the will of God. They can't take any glory for this. God established Egypt with great power, and then God meant to show his superior power. Create a huge nation, and then just totally show it that it's nothing compared to him. That's what he was up to. Next, Exodus 3, 19 and 20. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless compelled by a mighty hand. I'm going to take a really mighty king, and I'm going to help, and I know he's just going to not let you go. I'm going to have to compel him, but don't worry. I can compel him. I am God Almighty. Verse 20, so I will stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all the wonders that I will do in it. After that, he will let you go. Isn't it amazing? just as it were, almost a dare. I dare you, do whatever you can. You can't do anything, but I dare you, do whatever you can. I will show you that I am God and that you are not. Remember your place, king. Much more we could say along these lines. We see God as active then in the life of Pharaoh. Much more we could say, we'll leave it. I want to move on to the plagues. Leading up to the plagues and the plagues themselves, we see a God who's active. I'm not going to look at all the verses, but I want you to look at a few of them. What God is doing in the plagues, and as he prepares for the plagues, he's saying, I'm going to demonstrate my superiority to the people. I want the people to see that I am supreme. That's what God wants you to see, wants Egyptians to see, wants Israel to see. So Exodus 6, 7. I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God who has brought you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. God wants to work in such a way that there is no mistake who gets the glory. There's no way that the Israelites came out and said, look what we did. We are pretty awesome. There's absolutely no way. They didn't bring a single plague. They didn't part a single water. The Lord did it. This, by the way, maybe I'm getting too far ahead of myself at the end of the sermon. This is why you have to see that God is active in the world. Because if you don't see he's active in the world, then you only see that you're active in the world and you're inclined to give yourself too much glory. Look what I did. Look how I built this company. Look how I convinced these people to follow this, and look how much profit we've made. If you look at the world as you're the main actor and don't see that God is active, you will give yourself far too much glory. And perhaps, like Pharaoh, God will be forced to put you in your place. Which is exactly what he does. But I would just want to highlight here, God means for us as his people to see he's powerful and to say he gets the glory. He is all powerful. And then next we would say, God demonstrates his superiority to the Egyptians. Exodus 7, beginning of verse 3. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, Pharaoh will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt and bring my hosts, my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great acts of judgment. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. The Lord wants his people to know that he's the Lord, and he wants his enemies to know that he is the Lord. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt to bring the people of Israel from among them. The plagues also point to God's power. God's the actor. The plague of the frogs in Exodus 8, verse 10. And he said, tomorrow, Moses said, be it as you say, so that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God. The question was, when will the frogs leave? And he says, well, whenever God wants them to. When should I ask him? When have you had enough? Tomorrow? You'll be done with the frogs tomorrow? Okay, I'll have God do that. But I want you to know that God is taking the frogs away. And the whole reason that we're having this conversation is because you can't do anything about these frogs. In the hail, Exodus 9, 14, for this time I will send all my plagues on you yourself and on your servants and on your people so that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. What's the purpose of the plague? Maybe to let the people go, but that's not what's said here. So that you will know that there is nobody in all the earth like God. The locust, chapter 10, verse 1. And 2, the Lord said to Moses, go into Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I may show these signs of mine among you. Verse 2, that you may tell in the hearing of your sons and your grandsons how I have dealt harshly with the Egyptians and what signs I have done among them, that you may know that I am the Lord. God didn't just want his own people to know it, and he didn't just want his enemies to know that he was powerful. He wanted the people to tell their kids about the great power of God. By the way, if you're a parent, that's a good job for you. Tell your kids how God has been powerful in your life. Tell your kids the wonder of an all-powerful God. God delivers his people for his own glory. Again, God set this all up to show his awe-inspiring power. He sets up a powerful king and a powerful nation, and he puts that king in his place. And he does it all according to his own testimony to help that king know and everybody on earth know who the real king is. Israel's might cannot explain the deliverance, cannot explain the exodus. It just doesn't do it. Only a reference to an all-powerful God can we make sense of how this nation was brought out of Egypt. So we see that God saves his people. I'm going to drill down a little bit here at chapter 14. There's just so much of God at work that I'm going to just walk us through chapter 14. This is the parting of the Red Sea, and this is God saying what he did. Now, you don't have to, we're just reading God's words. God's telling us how it happened. So let's walk through chapter 14 a little bit. Notice how God is the primary actor. I'm not going to read every verse, but I want to read several important verses. God is the primary actor. Chapter 14, verse 4. I will harden Pharaoh's heart and he will pursue them. And I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his host, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. God is going to act in a way that stubborn Pharaoh will be stubborn. For this story to be as exciting as it is, Pharaoh actually has to follow Israel. Otherwise, it's just they walked out and Pharaoh gave up and the water was in front of them and they had some time and they built some boats and, you know, maybe build a bridge and they got out themselves. So, you know, and so the story's not nearly as exciting. If Pharaoh doesn't chase them with chariots and armies, this is a good story and yet not great. And what makes the story great is this stubborn, powerful king who says, okay, you can go. No, wait a minute, you can't. And how does God explain how that happened? I know the hardening of Pharaoh's heart is a very unpopular topic, except it's just here. And I'm just going to let God speak for himself again. God says, I will harden Pharaoh's heart. That's verse 4. Verse 8, and the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued the people of Israel while the people of Israel were going out defiantly. So if you want to figure out how that happened and you don't want to use God in this because it's a little messy because you're trying to figure out how does sovereignty and responsibility work together, just know that you want to tell the story in a way that improves on the Bible's version, which actually seems to give credit to the Lord. It's an improvement. Own your desire to improve the text. But as a person made by God for his glory, you must know your place. You can't improve it. You'll only make it worse. In an effort to save God because it's created some sort of problem in your mind, you've said, God, you can't be what you say you are. So he brings the people to the crisis at the water. Isn't that amazing? They've got to show up at water with this army coming behind, and there it is, verses 13 and 14. And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord. Isn't that an amazing privilege? They probably didn't feel very privileged at that moment, but here they are at a place where you had to be there to really get the full effect probably. You see the army coming, and you get to hear these words, see the salvation of the Lord, and you just got to, I don't know how it's going to work out, but I hope it does. I'm ready to see that salvation. Let's get that started. And yet here they are in this desperate, terrifying situation. And he says, see the salvation of the Lord. He will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you. And you have only to be silent. Incredible. He doesn't say, I know it's a huge army. Why don't you get a stick and see if you can beat him back? He says, no, actually, you won't even need to fight. The Lord will do your fighting today. Whatever it will take to deliver you from this terrifying situation, he will do. If you can't already be thinking forward to the gospel, you should be. Situations well beyond you, terrifying situations, you facing the wrath of God, and the Lord has to fight for you, not you fight for you. Well, we're jumping ahead. The Egyptians then, again, pursuing is part of God's work. Verses 17 and 18. That hardened word, I'm going to have to read it. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them. All right, so at this point, by the way, the waters have parted and God's people begin to go through. And what are the Egyptians going to do? That looks like a death trap. Let's get out of here. Let's just turn around and just head on home. It looks like Israel's God's pretty powerful. He's divided the waters and the ground's dry. I reckon what we ought to do is just head home. And instead, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And I will get the glory over Pharaoh and all his host, his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen. Amazing. God working. Apparently actively hardening. To get the army actually where he wants them to be, into the trap. Before that happened, there's a way that the Lord protects his people. There's a pillar. I don't need to spend a lot of time with that, but there's a way that he keeps God's people and the Egyptians separate. He puts a pillar in between them so that the Egyptians can't get to his people, right? Because you're thinking if they're gaining ground, eventually they'll catch them, and God sort of stands as a barrier between them. That's in verses 19 and 20. Again, the waters are powerfully parted. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove back the sea. The Lord drove the sea back. And then verses 24 through 28, again, listen to the active words of what the Lord's doing. Verse 24, and in the morning, watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and the cloud looked down on the Egyptian forces and threw the Egyptian forces into a panic. So how did they get to a panic? The Lord threw them into a panic. Again, giving credit to the Lord again, verse 25, clogging their chariot wheels so they drove heavily. Interesting. God clogged the wheels of the chariots. And the Egyptians said, let us flee from before Israel. For the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians. God didn't want the Egyptians to think that the Israelites were good fighters. He didn't want them to have high thoughts of Israel. He wanted the Egyptians to have high thoughts of Israel's God. Again, this is a good place for us to just remember that's what God's about with us. God's not mainly interested in the world having high thoughts of you, but having high thoughts of your God. Set yourself to do what God's doing. See, too often we are trying to get the world to have high thoughts of us, and God means for us to join him in getting the world to have high thoughts of him. He can save them, we can't. One more thing there in verse 29. As the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. Again, speaks of God's active work of throwing them into the sea. They were defeated. They were delivered by God's mighty hand. Verse 29, but the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. Again, the Lord did it. Israel didn't save themselves. God saved them. In verse 31, then, God is worshipped because this says, Israel saw the great power of the Lord that he used against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord. They believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. I realize I'm going longer than I meant to, but let me just emphasize one point that I think needs to be emphasized. We live in a world in which people want naturalistic explanations for everything that goes on. And some people, even within the church, have almost a deistic idea. That is, God made everything, and then he just kind of hangs out and lets everything run on its own. I'm going to tell you, that's not the way the Bible talks. The Bible doesn't act as if God is not active. Just imagine a modern newspaper writing an account of what happened in this event, the Exodus. Would they have written anything like what happened? No, they would have just said, no, Pharaoh is so stubborn. His stubbornness really overdid him. He's just the only one. Blame him and those wheels falling off. I mean, just shoddy craftsmanship. I've always said those Egyptians should really up their work. They need to work. They need to build better chariots. And yet we have the God-inspired version of the story. God active in Pharaoh. God active in making the chariots' wheels not work properly. God did it. Again, I think our problem sometimes is we don't like the doctrine of God's sovereignty. We don't like a powerful God. We have a problem with that. Sometimes we are confused. How could it be that he can be this powerful and people actually be responsible? And yet the Bible doesn't blush at these two truths. They're compatible. God can be just this powerful, and Pharaoh can be fully responsible for his own rebellion. I don't mean the effect of this sermon to be God's really powerful and that people aren't responsible. I think that both are clearly taught in Scripture. But the idea that you have to basically weaken God in order for people to be responsible is not a problem that God sees needs to be fixed. And I suggest we join God in not feeling like we need to fix it, but just affirm both completely and without reservation. Much more can be said, but we've got next week. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for revealing your glory, for showing yourself to be mighty and powerful in ways that the world does not want to admit. Thank you for showing yourself powerful in saving Israel in a way where Israel could never have saved themselves. It's only because you were active. Thank you for reminding us that you've taken the same sort of activity in our own salvation, where we couldn't save ourselves, and yet you sent your Son. He died on the cross. And by faith in Christ, in what you have done, not us, we are saved. Help us to love, to worship a sovereign God who fights for us, who works for us, who does what we cannot do. Help us to not be afraid to say that we are weak. And in a terrifying situation, if we're left to ourselves, help us to rejoice in the fact that you haven't left us to ourselves and worship you as the sovereign God. Work on our hearts even now to love this doctrine, even if we came in this room opposed to it. Help us to see that this is exactly the way you represent yourself in the Scriptures, and help us to love you as you reveal yourself. Guard us from attempts to make a God in our own image or a God as we would have him, but rather to accept you as you reveal yourself and to love you and to worship you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.